Today, and we do so on a very high note indeed with, as she was known, Gloriana, which I think is much nicer than the Virgin Queen. Gloriana, meaning of course that during her time as ruler, England had an extreme amount of glory under her rule. Think about how she became ruler, and her life prior to being ruler makes it all the more remarkable. I started thinking about her life as a girl. Can you imagine when your mother had her head chopped off? And your family, particularly, I think, after the birth of young Edward, doesn't really need her too much anymore, unless he had been planning a strategic marriage, but I've never read much about that either. As far as having a warm relationship with Sis, I don't see much possibility of that, considering Mary and her mother, Catherine of Aragon, considered her the B word, either one of the B words, actually. And in fact, there was reason to believe that under her sister, she may well have been subject to execution. So it's quite a story to think of going all those years and finally becoming ruler on your own after enjoying little or no security. But once she did, it was all about ruling and all about creating a kind of workable consensus that would work for her and the people that mattered. She's an interesting person on so many levels because even though she dealt with Parliament and certainly worked with them to the extent she felt it necessary, and that she actually went in public to work crowds to sort of make the people conscious of her, and that has, they tell us, something to do with her wide variety of outfits and wigs and all the rest that were so important in her appearance, which seems odd to think back in that day that a ruler would care about the people. But she did, because she had a lot that was important to do. And for those of you who are Episcopalians, we do think of her in particular significance when we think of the Church of England, a little bit Catholic and a little bit Protestant. It is, of course, vastly oversimplified, but I'll say it anyway, that a Protestant theology is more or less attached to a Catholic hierarchy, and we'll be talking more about that. It's very hard to do. And as far as I am aware, the Church of England alone among Christian groups was the only one who succeeded with that particular scheme. And second, of course, the inevitable conflict with the Spanish, which becomes the stuff of lore in English history, not the proudest moment in Spanish history. The essential destruction of the Spanish Armada, or most of it at least, and a great victory for England and a joy for everyone who has Anglophilia, because of course of the glory of Queen Elizabeth in her latter years. Now, you just stop and think, how much trouble would it be to get dressed up like that? you just don't slip into it and take off. It's hard work, but it's sort of like this I do for the people. I believe that. I know there is a degree of personal vanity, and I suspect by that time, if she didn't, she was definitely losing hair, so I suspect that was important because obviously that would be important to have a great array of wigs, but still, it's quite a get-up, I think you will acknowledge. Marriage must have been a very, very difficult matter, but she was a very well-educated person. She spent a lot of time. I think she knew 5 languages, spoke 5, read 5 with great facility. She knew very well that the minute a woman in power marries a man, the power begins to fade. And she was, based on the example of countless people in the past, determined that she would maintain her own authority. So she dabbled with various men, as we've seen in depictions in movies and television, but none of them, I would contend, were serious marriage material. And one even, the Earl of Essex, whom, according to all romantics, was her true love, was even executed. Execution was something she was wont to determine for people whom she thought deserved it. She did not have a problem with capital punishment, but she used it advisedly, because we were just talking about Bloody Mary, and it's not going to be Bloody Elizabeth. But there was still plenty of blood. And you wonder sometimes, well, why does Mary get all the rap and Elizabeth doesn't? I think it's because Elizabeth was able to shift this into a case not of a religious difference, but a national difference. By being disloyal to our faith, you're a traitor. And it seemed to work for her, at least among the majority of her subjects, who seemed to accept her and her particular ways. The only problem I know with capital punishment came with dealing with Cousin Mary. Not Sister Mary, but Cousin Mary. Because even though they were descended from the Tudor family, both of them, Mary Stuart really got in her craw, and ultimately she determined that she couldn't take it anymore. That is a strange business, this execution, as we will see, of Mary, Queen of Scots. The church took some time to work out, and she worked it out with Parliament. I'm not sure how much choice she gave them. And I think at the very beginning of her reign, the Catholics thought maybe there's a chance. I mean, Philip II, her brother-in-law, might send her a little note, and you know, buenos dias, senor, so that kind of thing, and say, you know, I'm still missing Mary, but I'm loving you too, and you're both great, because, you know, thinking about, well, if at first you don't succeed, try again. So there was talk about the possibility that he could marry Elizabeth. So I think she might have sort of said, well, come on over, we have a nice get-together and tell Mary's story, so that kind of thing, whatever, but just sort of playing with him, you might say. Ultimately, it didn't amount to hill of beans, as we say, because even though technically the church was still part of the papal network, it was said that she just got up and, as I guess great candles and torches were coming in the processional, she said, "Away with all that, I need it not," or something to that effect. And it meant, "We're going Protestant." And, you know, it's very strange because if you were a Catholic bishop, you're pretty much going to think, do I want to be a martyr or do I want to get a one-way ticket to the continent? A lot of those people just got out, decided, you remember some of the bishops like Thomas Cranmer got out under Queen Mary. Most of these Catholic bishops just leave and they are replaced. Because as the changes are going about, thanks to the laws accepted by the Queen after being encouraged by herself and her floor managers in Parliament, who in fact will approve this act of supremacy. I did underline the word governor, which I think is so interesting, because some say that some of the parliamentarians could not believe a woman could be head. I know. So you're thinking, oh, please. Yeah, but governor is as far as they could go. This was hard enough for them. You can imagine. So we'll let it go, you know, we'll go, ooh. But yes, she can be supreme governor, and that's absolutely it. So she's okay with that. She's now supreme governor of the church. And of course, we got to work on that Book of Common Prayer. Why do we have to work on it? Well, because for Elizabeth, it was too Protestant. Those of you who are familiar with the Book of Common Prayer can read it and presumably see what you want to see or think what you want to think. But it's probably true that in the so-called Edwardian version, which was composed during the reign of King Edward, the wording was such, for example, that the service of Holy Communion was Protestant in viewing the communion or the Lord's Supper as simply a remembrance of Christ's death and the eating of the bread and the drinking of the wine. Elizabeth couldn't take that. That was too much. She didn't even want to see bishops with wives. So they kept them at home. You know what I mean? They were an official activity. Sorry, dear, we can't go to the palace together. You just, I'll try to get back early and bring you some of the refreshments. You know, that kind of thing. So, no wives. She's not, exactly. It's just that kind of thing. You know, we're just not ready for it, you know. But, I mean, many, they had the wives. I mean, they were openly married. It's not that. It's just she wasn't ready for it. Now, in terms of the prayer book, they did add phraseology such as in the communion, "This is my body which was shed for you and for many." And the convenient part of that is, whichever way you want to go, fine. As Elizabeth said, we cannot make windows into the souls of men. What does that mean? We don't know what people believe. And I don't care. What I care about is we have outward conformity. Everybody go to church and shut up, okay? Basically, that's it. And if you are some troublemaker, then you're a traitor, and I hate you. Okay, yeah, I mean, it's kind of simple in a way, if you see this middle path. But the act of uniformity is supposed to prevent deviance. And that, of course, means that the government might have royal commissioners go around to check on churches. You know, it's funny when you think about it, some little church in Boondocksville or somewhere, and you look in the back pew and there's some big shot sitting back there taking notes. And you think, uh-oh. And, you know, maybe you're, God forbid, having the service in Latin. Oh, yeah. Or you are facing the altar. You're doing things, in other words, that will remind people of Catholicism. He said, you know, that's against the rules. So these kinds of matters could be very, very significant. And again, many people say this is not because of religious faith on the part of Elizabeth. People have doubts as to whether she had any at all. It's a matter of believing that the kingdom should have one religion, one faith. And if you don't like it, maybe you'd be happy somewhere else. You know, that kind of attitude. So this is not, I think, a case of religious tolerance by any means whatsoever. Were there Catholics lingering? You betcha. But they were quiet Catholics. They were doing it in the privacy of their own homes, behind closed doors, as the old song used to go. It was not something you would want to, hey, you want to come to a mass? I would think that could be trouble, okay? Agents might get a hold of you. But we'll see how that's going to work out later. This is just, you see, in 1559. Remember, she's just really become ruler. Now here is Mary, Queen of Scots, not to be confused with Mary Tudor. As I've indicated, she was a descendant of Henry VII. What an interesting life she'd had before she became Queen of Scotland. Her background was as wife to the future King of France. Unfortunately, for, I guess, herself, he died before becoming King of France, and she'd had no children, so of course, she shipped home. That's what happens to childless widow queens. But she's back to Scotland. Scotland is a beautiful place, as many of you know who visited there. It's wonderful. Scotland's great. But after you've seen Paris, Edinburgh can be a little rough around the edges. So it was said that she did not adjust well, even though she had a very strong background. To me, in many ways, Mary, Queen of Scots, is very much a product of the Franco-Scottish relationship. Her mother was a powerful French noblewoman, as her father had been King of Scotland. And of course, that meant that her grandmother and sister to Henry VIII, remember Margaret? Yeah, we're going to get that tree, I promise. I know you're just dying for it. You know, just don't you worry about that. She will lose her throne for supposedly being flighty. Yes, that's a word you don't hear much anymore. But if it's true, she has a lot of provocation, as you will know, those of you who followed all the novels and all the movies and all of the tripe about Mary, Queen of Scots, of which there has been a lot. She was married to a cousin, and apparently he was immature and selfish and possibly responsible for the death of one of her favorites, Rizzio, if you know that story. And ultimately, she becomes involved, more than a friend perhaps, with a dashing nobleman, the stuff of which novels are made, Oathwell, and apparently after having a child, she and Bothwell will get away after Darnley is killed. All of this is to say that she will end up crossing the border after being deposed as Queen of Scotland. As I note this, I must note that she was brought up in the Roman Catholic faith of her ancestors. And when she arrived back, she heard about a man who denounced the rule of women and who said that Geneva was the most perfect school of Christ ever on earth. And of course, Scottish people throughout the room will know I'm speaking of John Knox. Yes. Presbyterian. Yes, Bob. Presbyterians, I don't know, still proclaim his name as one of their great Scottish heroes. Whatever the case, this was not going to be a love fest. When she arrives from France, John Knox is going to say, well, you know, we have some differences in our faith, but we're just Scottish and we just love each other. No, you are a harlot and I denounce you. So, yeah, that was not going to be a pleasant relationship because she was dealing with a large portion of the population of Scotland that were of a different religious faith already. And she wasn't going to say, well, maybe I'll just try out this Presbyterian thing and maybe I'll try it, you'll like it, you know, that kind of thing. She was Catholic and that's what she was going to stay. So that's part of it. And part of it has to do with her love life, I guess you might say. In any event, she was deposed by the Scottish nobles in their wisdom. And she crossed the border from Edinburgh into northern England, assuming that her cousin down in London would welcome her with open arms. There were no arms, opened or otherwise, and she remained in the north of England for many, many years to come. During those years, and many people love knitting and crocheting and pursuing other hobbies like equestrianism. I can just think of all the great things you can do if you're a royal prisoner. I mean, it's not like, you know, you have to make license plates. This is good prisoner, okay? This is grade A prison care. So you do all kind of nice, fun things. Prayer books, rosary beads, everything a royal prisoner could like. But what if someone in the staff there of the facility saying you are really the true Queen of England because this so-called queen is a disciple of Satan and you are true? I mean, it goes to your head. Yeah, you look up from your basket, you know, you're weaving, and you're thinking, wow, I am queen. Henry VII was my great-grandfather. I'm a Tudor. So that's part of it, and of course, it was not a good idea. As we're going to see, during her many years, almost two decades, in captivity, pleasant captivity, but captivity nonetheless, she will allow herself to be used by these elements. Let me take you back now, shall we, for many, many years, and you may recognize Glenda Jackson and Vanessa Redgrave. in a meeting that never happened. But that's okay. We do not go to movies for history. We go for entertainment, right? And Glenda was one of my favorite Elizabeths, I have to say. I mean, we all have our own favorite. Maybe Betty Davis is yours. Who is the latest one? Yeah, Kate, she done it. I'm thinking of someone a little older. Yeah. Helen Mirren. Yeah. So, I mean, it's a great role for an actress. Let's face it, one of the greatest. I just found this one so interesting because, I don't know, there were a lot of people in the theater when I saw it that I thought, a lot of us here wanted this to happen. It's like they made it happen. Hollywood made it happen for us, and it was just really exciting. You had that popcorn. I'm just really excited while it was going on because it was a weird kind of meeting. I mean, you know, it's sort of like, it's not like a real warm reunion, but it's sort of like, yeah, there's you and there's me and here we are and see you around, you know, that kind of thing. But very important that at least in the minds of those of us who are interested in this, that they really never did get together. And I guess it was because maybe Elizabeth was afraid she would like her. I don't know. But whatever the case, they never came near each other, even though, of course, by blood, they were cousins. Mary's end, yeah, was not a pleasant matter. The first time I ever saw this act was on an old television show. It was called You Are There. Yes. And I'm thinking, should a 10-year-old been watching a show like this? Well, they didn't say, parents, avoid this violence that's about to come. Because it was very dramatic, though, because of course, she had her little dogs and they were hiding in her skirts. So dog people will find that. And of course, they had imported someone from France, an expert, to perform the deed. Of course, the priest was there. All of this is to say that Elizabeth had determined that Mary was better to her dead than alive, particularly after the whole business of Catholic cross. And there it was. Farthingay. No. That was just one of the ladies in waiting. They would never have had... Queen Elizabeth, you know, said, did you have that done? You know, she pretended it was sort of in the papers that she was signing. She said, shucks, I didn't mean for you to bring that execution thing. Lord have mercy, I really am sorry about that, you know. Right. She was really, redhead, she was mad as she could be. It was like, you made me do this. And then they, of course, you know, when it's your boss, they said, you're right, we made that mistake. She said, oh, I'm mad, I'm not going to talk to you all. You know, all of that, because maybe she didn't want it on her conscience. You know, shedding royal blood is not something you do. It's a very small club. And so, do it to one, it could get done to you. So, because she had more than her share of people who wanted her dead. Believe you me, Elizabeth, for many, many years, had understood that feeling that there were many enemies out there. But it was a very, very gruesome business. And it took a long time, as you can see, for it to happen. And that has a lot to do with the fact that I think Elizabeth just didn't want to execute a queen, even though she was clearly in league against Elizabeth. Now, you might ask yourself, but Mary wasn't her subject. I think that's always an interesting point. She wasn't English. She was Scottish. But they found the letters. They knew she was involved in plots. It was easy enough to prove. We can go through this whole masquerade about I didn't mean to sign that. It was you darn administrators. I blame you entirely. And then you get the next morning. It's another day. And Mary's dead. So, and I'm queen. So, yeah, it's just a brutal reality that. Look at him. Boy, oh boy. He's a saint now, Pius V. Now, if you look at the background, it doesn't look like a happy background. Yeah, you saw it, didn't you? Yeah, because there's some bad folks out there. And Pius V was serious about getting on to those Protestants and other troublemakers. He is a pope of the Catholic Reformation. And he thought a lot about Elizabeth, none of it good. And I bring him up out of all of the popes of this period because no one, I think, better symbolizes the, shall we call it, fervency and excitement of the Counter-Reformation. Because it is truly a battle for the souls of humanity. We're fighting for them against the Protestants. And we will prevail. And of course, we have a layperson to help us in this crusade. And of course, that's going to be Philip II of Spain. After Philip II gave up his efforts, you know, it's like, maybe we can get together and just talk or, you know, just visit. And after she said, well, I'd like to, but I'm awfully busy this week, or I've got to wash my hair, whatever, it's like he gives up. And as his role as sort of this great champion of Catholicism goes on, Pius V, we'll decide it's time to act against Elizabeth. I guess maybe Pius or the popes in general thought, perhaps we can work out some sort of deal with her. Perhaps if she marries Philip, we can have some understanding. Well, obviously that isn't going to work. So, 1570... time to do it. Yep. You're a bastard. And you can go to hell. And you say, wow, that's strong language. And meant to be. Because we're cutting the tie. You know, before that it had always, well, maybe something can work out. And, you know, we like you and you like us. It's something, It's all over. And now we welcome people who want to invade England and take you out so you can hurry on your trip to Burning Hill. So, it is a religious declaration of war, if one is needed. Because Philip was leading this warfare in many other directions. In the east, he'd had a tremendous victory over Turkish forces. And this became another instance of the great Catholic Spanish forces, much dedicated, of course, to his grandparents, Philip and Isabella, will now be directed against that wretch, Elizabeth, and all the evil things that she's done in England. And I have no one less than the venerable pontiff who is going, go, rah, rah, you know, that sort of thing. So we've got a strong working on the anti-Elizabeth force. Now, many people wondered if Pius was not acting prematurely. In fact, English Catholics who were still practicing their Catholicism in the privacy of their own homes could sort of come out in public and say, hey, did you go to Mass last week? Yeah, what about you? Yeah, we went to Mass. But we do it privately. We don't tell other people. You don't rush up to somebody in the Church of England and say, we love our Catholic Church and you've got a nice church too. No. All of ours is, you know, covert. They worship by, you mean how do they worship? Private homes. Presumably they had their own priests or others who would carry out the services, or if they didn't, they would just have. But the fact is, they were sort of left alone to do it because many of them were upper class. I mean, so Elizabeth just sort of liked to close her eyes and pretend it wasn't going on. You know, sometimes when you're in trouble. But now, you know, it's sort of like, okay, if your big leader has declared I'm illegitimate and not to be on the English throne, then maybe I better go inspect your houses, you lousy Catholics. You know, that kind of thing. So this 1570 act of the Pope does make things very serious. And Elizabeth has to begin probably to execute more people than she really wanted to. But again, they are traitors. Traitors to the crown for failure to recognize her as supreme governor, and for failure to follow the Book of Common Prayer. And you say, well, I wonder if all those Presbyterians were so keen on the Book of Common Prayer. We'll get to them, because they can be troublemakers too. But Catholics are just more trouble right now, okay? And these other troublemakers are coming. Now, these problems, of course, were added to by everybody's favorite group of agents, the Society of Jesus. The Society of Jesus, Jesuits, would actually be found in this period, in the 16th century, by a Spaniard by the name of Loyola. And Loyola was, as he viewed himself, a knight for Christ. He said, if the Pope says white is black, it is. And in the spiritual exercise and training his followers, they were to be agents, not like traditional monks. Traditional monks wore their habits and lived in their houses or worked with the poor. Jesuits did not necessarily wear any distinctive clothing. Many of them were educators. Boy, Carol, they would love that core curriculum because Jesuits wanted plenty of language, philosophy, history, foreign language. Think of the Jesuit schools that are named Loyola even today. Those traditions are still very important, and I praise them for it. But let's think of them also as secret agent men. Yeah, because they were out to, I mean, this would be like a Tom Cruise movie. I mean, something, we could see some of these people crossing the channel disguised as a mild-mannered businessman. But we know that they are papal agents. Your job? Although the secretary will deny any knowledge if you are caught. Because they are, you know, they got a hit list, including Elizabeth. And you say, oh no, wouldn't that be a regicide? Okay, let me explain regicides. There are good regicides and there are bad regicides. This would be a good one. This would be all the Jesuit honor roll if you're able to get Elizabeth. So these Jesuits somehow seem to get into England regularly. they had been in contact with Mary up in northern England. They had, of course, been in touch with Philip II, because Philip II had various ideas about either making himself, once Elizabeth was done, that he would make himself king of England, perhaps make Mary his companion or agent. Those plans were not totally clear, at least they're not clear to me. In any event, some Jesuits made it to live. Some did not. Some died. But it's just interesting to think that you can't seal England off and prevent this kind of Catholic underground from developing. And it was very strong, and it had to be a very important issue for her and her idea of being able to maintain one church for all the English people. This Titian painting, which I think I saw at the Prado in Madrid, I think I did. It is one of my favorite paintings of Philip II, who was a very serious fellow. You can also see outside Madrid his famous palace, the Escorial, which has the, it's basically dedicated to the Catholic faith and to Spain. He's a great believer in the Inquisition and did not care for the Protestants or Muslims. He saw only one true faith. The idea of Elizabeth continuing on as ruler was, of course, greatly offensive to him. Remember how perhaps he felt that his great aunt, Catherine of Aragon, had been treated. The English people had never liked him when he was Queen Mary's husband. You notice they never made him king. For the reasons, he was definitely motivated to be the Catholic savior who would overthrow Queen Elizabeth. And these individuals, like Sir Francis Drake, all the great English ship captains who would gain Spanish treasure, really annoyed him, because how long had this been going on? Since his grandparents' day. Spain had been enriching itself as the cost at the expense of America, and now the English wanted to get in on it. Drake and other sea captains, you might want to call them pirates, were responsible for taking a lot, and by this point, relations between England and Spain were such that there was no chance that Elizabeth was going to say, oops, we're very sorry, I'm going to discipline Sir Francis when he gets home. I don't think, in other words, this is part of it. And Philip said, okay, if it's going to be like that, then maybe I need to do something. After all, the Pope has pretty much said what you are. You're illegitimate. You're not really the queen. You're going to be removed, and God's kingdom will be restored in England. And we'll pick up right there after your 5-minute break. English lore. Many years ago, I would have said something like, every English school child knows about, I'm not so sure about that anymore, but at one time, he would have been on the list of famous people in English history, certainly because of his derring do and the fact that he really annoyed Philip II of Spain. The defeat of the Spanish Armada, and most of the Armada was destroyed. Some of it limped back to Spain, was a decisive moment in the reign of Queen Elizabeth, and I'm sure that of Philip II. I suppose it would depend on whose side you were on to determine how you want to view it. But insofar as the roles of England and Spain are concerned for the future, it simply means that the one has maintained itself, England, and Spain has suffered something of a decline. But as we are going to see, that decline was already going on for the Spanish. They just didn't know it. Sometimes it takes events like this. As far as England is concerned, yes, it was a great moment. And no doubt about it, Elizabeth was a great Protestant hero by defeating this great Catholic army. And it was not so much a nationalist business of Spain versus England, but it was the Catholics versus the Protestants. I think very much we need to see it in the context of religion. Now you might say, well, where are all the other Catholics? Well, they don't necessarily like Spain, and that's one of the great ironies. It's like, we're all together. No, we're not. It's like each power for itself. And that's one of the odd and complicated things about this business. They're not even united, although we can see it in the sense of Catholic versus Protestant. She died in 1603, leaving for the future enormous debts, various interests in the New World, and religious problems to come with some fairly feisty Presbyterians already wondering about causing trouble. But while Elizabeth was alive, they were a bit sensitive about her feelings. There was, at a time, one member of Parliament had actually spoken about maybe we could modify that Book of Common Prayer and make it a little bit more according to the teachings of the Blessed John Calvin. And he found himself checked in the next day to the Tower of London. You say, but I thought honest, conscientious debate among members, not so much. The Queen had representatives there and said, that was very ugly for you to talk like that, you know. That is not a subject that's up for discussion. So, but it's very funny to me how she would say, here are your limits, what you can talk about, what you can do, and if you go past that, you'll be in trouble. Normally, however, it was sort of like, yeah, we have to limit it now, but the old girl, she won't be around forever. But we love her, she's wonderful. But someday, she's gonna be gone, and boy, things are gonna be great. And you can imagine, if you were a Calvinist, this is, oh, happy day. Of course, I'm sure they went to the funeral and cried and all through all that. But they're thinking, now the old girl's gone, we can get this church fixed up the way it ought to be. And that is going to be their plan, because guess what? We got a man coming. Yeah, a real man. And this whole horrible woman rule can stop, because many of the men had sort of honored her as the queen, but behind closed doors, they said, you know, this whole queen business is just unnatural. You know, they just have no business having a woman ruler. But that's between you and me. Let's keep it between ourselves. You know, that kind of thing. But you know very well that many would not have been comfortable. She apparently found it difficult to proclaim to even to her most intimate advisors that James VI of Scotland was to be her successor. He, of course, was the son of Mary, Queen of Scots. He'd never known his mother. His mother had basically left without him not long after he was born. So he was brought up by guardians in Scotland and became King of Scotland as a small child. Now, because of his claims, and there was some correspondence between them, but she never met him before. I'm sure there was some very formal correspondence between them. But ultimately, she said, it will be my cousin, the King of Scotland. Why do you ask? It's more or less, why do you need for me to tell you this? You should figure it out, Dunderhead. You know, that kind of thing. And it's like, really, that's not fair. Because they were just trying to ascertain her will, because there were others who might qualify as being future rulers. But in fact, James VI will get the word when she dies in 1603. And we can imagine in Edinburgh the joy he felt. Not at so much at the death of Queen Elizabeth, but the fact that he was going south. Because, of course, the idea of going south as a Stuart, remember his mother was Mary Stuart, as a Stuart, James VI will now be both King of Scotland and at age 37, King of England as well. It is not correct to say that he is head of the United Kingdom, because it's not united. He is king of two different kingdoms. So if you don't want to offend any of your Scottish friends, you always need to say King James VI of Scotland and King James I of England. Or King, you know, and on James VI, James VII, you know, and on to make sure that they don't get offended by not giving their Scottish numbers. Because the unification of the kingdoms does not occur until the end of the Stuarts. And we may yet witness that split, we don't know. But at the present time, this unification of them under one ruler, at least having that one ruler, takes place in 1603. What an interesting character he was. And again, the idea of his popularity may surprise us because he had many unattractive qualities, but he was a man. That was number one. So that gives him several points right there, okay? Just being a man. He's a family man. And he seemed to have Presbyterian leanings. He might have had, you know, I heart John Knox, you know, that kind of thing. And you say, but his mother was a devout Catholic. Hey, how long has it been since you got together with Mom, huh? So the idea is that in many ways he'll be very appealing. But that's the idea. Have you ever heard Absence makes the heart grow fonder. That was probably the English public and James. He's up in Edinburgh, and it's sort of like he's there, he's a man, he's a family man. He seems to appreciate Calvinist ideas. He's the whole package. And then he arrives and something ugly happens called reality. And it's just he opens his mouth. And I love a nice Scottish brogue. Isn't it nice when the... But you know, you ask, you go to London and get an English person over near, be real quiet and say, do you enjoy the Scottish brogue? Ask them what they'll say. It'll be negative, I promise you. They don't say, oh yes, it's charming. They don't care for it. So they consider it to be sometimes in the North, our Southern accent, you know, can get rather tiresome. And I'm afraid that when he opened his mouth, and he had a very broad Scottish voice, they couldn't stand it. And there are other many on the points of reasons to dislike the new king, but they're coming soon. But for right now, merely note that he was very happy. Now, there wasn't going to be one government in London. That won't come until much later, with the last of the Stuarts, Queen Anne. For now, he will be king in each place, and presumably, he'll go on occasion back to Edinburgh. But let's face it, Edinburgh's lovely, but London's pretty much where the action is. So it will be primarily a king in England, but he will also be king of Scotland. And there will be a Scottish government, which he had been in charge of. He was now 37 years old. And he's been nominal king for more than three decades, when you think about it. He was used to dealing with those rough and tumble Scottish nobles. He had been reared in the faith of the Church of Scotland, which was now Calvinist. And he seemed to have all of the qualities that this English Parliament, now liberated from good Queen Bess, were prepared for. Now, what is there not to like? Well, I mentioned the accent. How do we like these fashions of the period? Could you imagine wearing that outfit? No. Would you think that would that be uncomfortable, do you think? How would you like to sit in there? What would you... I mean, I don't won't even try to demonstrate, but let's just say it would be difficult. And she apparently... And this will be... The parliamentarians can be so funny. You know, they think it's so wonderful to have a family man as king. Well, you know, family men have something called greater bills. Queen Elizabeth can live more inexpensively, despite her clothing costs, wig bills. She still had less bills than he does, because he's got a wife and three children. So they're going to find that Anne of Denmark, his wife, and she was a Dane, was going to be expensive, and rearing three children, as many of you know, is not an inexpensive item in a budget. And when you pass it on to the good people of England as well as Scotland, there will be some who will say, we need some cost-cutting measures or something of the sort, because that will be a problem. And it's very ironic to me that they all thought this was so wonderful, and yet when it comes to the reality of cost, because of course, going from Scotland to England, he thinks he's in Money City. I mean, you know, we've gone from the poverty of Scotland, in financial terms, into Money City, which is London. Because of course, just as today, England's a lot richer than Scotland. So, all of this is going to be a problem. Now, as far as the faith is concerned, his following these ideas of Calvinism does not mean that he had any intention of messing with the Church of England. There will be a separate Church of Scotland, and there will also be a Church of England, and technically he will be head of both of them, which is kind of weird if you stop and think about it, because they're not the same at all. Church of Scotland, thank you, John Knox, is essentially Calvinist, whereas the Church of England is sort of a little of this. It's just a big old stew, isn't it? It's got a lot of different qualities. But a lot of these Calvinists, when he gets into England, say, he's going to help us change things. And that's why we're glad to have this new king. He talks funny, but we can forgive him for that because he's a man of God. He's got a wife and a family. He believes the right way. So it's going to be great. Oh boy, have they got surprises ahead. He looks rather devilish in that, doesn't he? He had lots of habits they didn't like. I spoke about the way that he talked. But one thing he liked to do, he loved hunting, and he liked to really get in with the animal parts. They talk about, I know, I won't demonstrate, but I think he did like to get in with it, and he had it all over himself, and he was rather a disgusting individual, but all of this is still not enough to totally ruin the reception into England in 1603. However, there were people who did not like him, and even today, the English celebrate the Guy Fawkes Day. I wonder how many people actually know. I tried to mention up here what it was about, which would have endeared him, of course, to Protestants throughout England when a cabal of Catholics tried to eliminate him, and we understand, of course, that they failed to do so. This gunpowder plot there in Parliament, and as I say, it's still celebrated today. What he represented, however, was not so much a threat to Catholics. Again, if they had just kept quiet and carried out their religion, I suppose, behind closed doors, he was not prepared to try to eliminate them. He had many other issues to deal with. For one thing, he had to deal with the amount of debt that had been left by Elizabeth's government. He had to deal as well with the problem of what would happen to the Church of England, because it was clear that all the elements within the Church of England were not prepared to act together cohesively, and that was going to be a concern as well. And they let him know right off the bat. Now, as I say, Calvinists and those who supported those kinds of doctrines constituted a big group. They were kind of quiet under Elizabeth, but they had reason to support their doctrine. And let me mention their doctrine very briefly. Their doctrine of election more or less told them that God has set aside certain people for reasons of his own, that is God, and they were destined for salvation. But we do not know who they are. The rest of us, we are going to the other place. Now, how do you know? Well, Calvin would speak about signs of election. You don't know for sure, but you open up and there's some big fat check, you've just gotten a promotion. Those kinds of things are signs that you are one of the chosen. Because perhaps you're prospering here on earth and you go, that may be one of the special ones. And yeah, and you may go to hell too. I mean, but it's a sign. These signs lead us to believe that people, particularly people I've talked about, the gentry, they would get these signs and say, look at my crops. Oh boy, all my crops are looking great. Oh, my business is expanding. Or I guess today we would speak, oh, look at my diverse portfolio. Oh, you know, my IRAs are just blossoming. All of this foolishness, and people say, those are signs that I'm one of God's elect, you know? And it seems odd to us, but that's the way that some may have believed. And in fact, it's hard to imagine the masses of people, we're talking about people who get dirty every day and work, that they necessarily saw themselves having any of the signs of election. Some people claim that Calvinism could be a kind of upper middle class religion. Maybe so, maybe not. But they would see these signs of prosperity. They would see these signs of life's blessings and view this as a sign of their eternal redemption to come. Now, Calvin didn't all say that, but that's the way they interpreted what he said. And all of this leads them to take a position as members of Parliament, to want to straighten out the world according to their ideas. And you can't come up to one of them and they're trying to straighten everything out and you say, look, I'm going to hell anyway. Would you just let me drink and go on hell? No. You don't know. You might be one of the saved. Probably not. But you might be. And we can't take the chance. So we got to clean up your act. So that's part of the problem of being the elect. We got to get it all set up for you all. Now, they had been quiet, as I say, for the most part, under Queen Elizabeth. She insisted upon it. But once she's dead, they are ready to move and cleanse this church of all the remnants of Catholicism. Yes. You just say rosary bead and their skin will just break out in hives. Yes. I mean, it's like they don't want any touch of that in their church. In 1604, shortly after he became king, he met with church leaders, both clerical and lay, and one would think that they had in mind to put into his head the idea that they wanted change, and they wanted him as king to support change. And they had big changes in mind at this Hampton Court conference. They had biblical changes in mind. He said, oh, that sounds great. Let's work on that. And they were going, wow, great. Translation. And of course, that is the King James Bible, which I think is still used in hotels and motels and given out on campus every term by the Gideons. And so it still has a life of its own after all these centuries. So that's the King James Bible. And of course, it got its name because he approved of this translation as king. Because remember, he is supreme governor now of the church. So far, so good. And then these Calvinists, it's sort of like you take it one step at the time, and can I get this? You know, you've seen children do that. And then the next step is they say, well, since we agree about this nice new English Bible, we love you so much, you're a great king. We wondered if we could abolish bishops. Ooh. No, no, no. That is not going to happen. Apparently, he said, no bishop, no king. And that's an interesting concept if you think about no bishop, no king. In other words, y'all want to get rid of the bishops, okay? Then, if you don't need bishops, how do I know you will need me? Maybe you don't want a king. So, shut up. And that's end of discussion. But it was out there. Because of course these people are Presbyterians. They don't want bishops. Even Anglican bishops, much less Catholic ones. So you're setting up a kind of like we get part of the deal that we want, but we're not going to get everything. As I indicate otherwise, they had wanted an end to confirmation. Thank you very much. Baptism's all we need. No. We're going to have confirmation or using the term priest. They don't like that because it smacks of popery, as we will hear in the 17th century. Popery, yeah, because it's sort of like they're smelling a papist everywhere, you know. Even among these good Anglicans, because of just the use of the word priest. So, they've had their honeymoon period, sort of. That Hampton Road conference, we're going to come out with this great new King James Bible. We probably are going to see some changing going on in the church. But, otherwise, some terrible problems. The beloved son of the king and the queen died in the midst of all this. He was a teenager. And a lot of people don't know about him, and that's why I wanted to bring him up, because the successor was not the chosen heir to the throne. This was the heir. This was the oldest child. And he was to have been king. He would have been Henry the Ninth, and he died at 16, and the throne would then go to Charles, as in chop chop, 1649. Yes, so another one of the great might have beens of English history. This young man, very tragic. Oh, I love her. She was married to a Protestant ruler in Bohemia. And you say, why? Oh, I think it's religion. Strategic reasons and religious reasons. Bohemia, Czechoslovakia, as it was, would be an important part of the Holy Roman Empire. And Elizabeth, daughter of King James I, would now marry a Calvinist prince, because she was Calvinist, and I guess she learned German. And she and her husband, the so-called Winter King, would have a major role in that war that started and ended on time, the 30 Years' War. 1618 to 1648. We don't get to do that very often. But yeah, right on time. The 30 Years' War. It is a conflict that few know about generally because of the complexities of the Holy Roman Empire. And as far as people in England are concerned, English history, It's not one in which the English played a major role. I don't think James I had the money, and I don't think Parliament was willing to get involved to any great extent. Briefly, what happened was this. The Habsburg rulers of the Holy Roman Empire were dealing with some states that were Lutheran. Other states were Calvinist. And they've got a real fired up Catholic emperor. Not a good combination. And the Catholic emperor is basically like, he's like a cousin of Philip II of Spain. I think we can leave it at that. And he wants to get those Lutherans and Calvinists straightened out, this Catholic emperor. And you see all the different colors. So everybody else decides to get involved. We'll help y'all. Because we love you because you're Catholic. We love you because you're Protestant. Let us help you. Well, of course, Elizabeth was married to one of the Protestant leaders. So she says, Daddy, can't you send us some money to help? He said, well, sweetie, I'm going to try. I want to get what I can, but your Parliament's acting real ugly with your mother's bills. And now, want to send you all a nice check, you and Frederick. So it's that's part of it, but there are other powers involved too. Sweden is a major power in this, if you can believe it. You see the Dutch up there. The French want to get involved to watch that empire. And of course, Spain is helping the Catholic side. So it's really a big old mess, this 30 years war. And what our concern with is to understand that James is involved because of his daughter and because of his own view that England should have some role in terms of standing up for the Protestants. And remember, England's already had that role thanks to the conflict between Elizabeth and Philip of Spain. Because these are, as we say in the South, kissing cousins of Philip's family. They are all Habsburgs. They're just cousins. Same tree, different branches. Now, how do you get people in Parliament to like you? Why don't you read one of your books to them? Yes, this is a key to popularity. And do not yawn. Do not slump over as if sleeping. Do not do anything like that because the king is reading. It was called The True Law of Free Monarchy. It was a quasi-theological tract in which he said kings are like gods on earth, little g. Yeah. And basically, you all are my subjects, and I love you to death. You're so great, but I'm king. I'm one of God's lieutenants on earth, and what do you do when I say? You just wiggle and say whatever you think best. Why did he think this? He read the Bible a lot, and he got it out of that. He didn't get it out of Scotland, because I don't think those Scots were treating him like a god on earth, because they could be right rambunctious. The idea, though, is that he had an idea which, well, we might as well go on and call it divine rights monarchy. Now, you can say you're a divine rights monarch. That's wonderful. You can call yourself anything you want to. But try to carry it out and see if it works for you. That's a whole nother matter. And many scholars think that he'd gotten all these great ideas, you know, working it up in the library and, you know, working with his Bible. And said, I'm a divine, I'm an answer to God alone. But it didn't work in Scotland. Well, I'll try that in England. They'll love it in England. It's more sophisticated than these rough Scots. Didn't work in England. And as a matter of fact, maybe there's even more resentment in England than there had been in Scotland. They didn't want to hear about he got all this power from God. Elizabeth, she just didn't talk about it. They say that was one of her great skills. She knew when to keep her mouth shut. You know, it's like, I'll just do what I want to do. I will be the great ruler, but I'm not going to lecture them about it. He wanted them to hear him discuss it in detail. And he wanted them to say, oh, we love it. We agree with you completely. You're so wonderful. You know, you just need a wind-up parliament doll who will say a nod, you know, that kind of thing. And it just did not work. Because these people he was talking to thought they were the elect. So, and he's telling them, you obey me, because I'm a little God. Big God, little God. So, yeah, that isn't going to work. Then there is another problem. He has his favorites. And when you have favorites, then you're going to have all kinds of powerful people who are going to say, why can't I be a favorite? Why can't I have power? Well, why do these people enjoy such high positions? And he treats us not as we should be treated. Now, I've already said that he was very Scottish. He was very crude. They spent a lot of revenues. And he wouldn't give in fully to these Calvinist demands for changes in the religion of the Church of England. But now, not unlike rulers we've talked about in this course before, to wit, Edward II, this whole business of favoritism for the few over the interests of the individuals who had authority and would be resentful would cause James I of England great problems. And we will look at one of them by the name of George Villiers. George Villiers. That is a painting of him. He was young enough to have been his son. And actually, he would get along quite well with James' son, Charles. So George Villiers became a kind of protege. But like many proteges, he would get out of control because he had never had power. He had never enjoyed that kind of privilege before. As a commoner, George Villiers would not normally be associated with dukes and earls and the wealthy elements that normally surround themselves by the king. But now Villiers is sort of adopted, and he's not the first. He's just the latest and the most successful at it. And he becomes increasingly powerful and arrogant and possessed of power and title so that he felt able to basically tell people that this is supposed to be him in his tights and all done up and said he's supposed to have the best pair of legs of any man around. And basically he could become very, very high and mighty. The king gave him the title Duke of Buckingham. And boy, you can just imagine, because people would say, upstart. He's come from nothing. Upstart. But again, he would say, well, the king says this, the king says that. And people just don't like that. And he will cause the king's reputation. And I don't think they were worried about sex at all. I really don't. That's not the major issue. The major issue is power. Who's got control? Who's got control? And this George Villiers, Duke of Buckingham, had great power. He would have great power during much of King James' reign and during the early years of the reign of King Charles. And there we will begin next time. Thank you very much.